beyond, red roofs about a narrow wharf in cluster, then altered a church, and higher, a long street climbs to one tall towering mill. And high in heaven above it, a gray down with Danish barrows, and a hazel wood, by autumn nutters haunted, flourishes green in a cup-like hollow of the down.
Thank you.
So these were wed, and merrily rang the bells. And merrily ran the years, 7 happy years. 7 happy years of health and competence, of mutual love and honorable toil, with children, first a daughter. In him woke, with his first babe's first cry, the noble wish to save all savings to the utmost, and give his child a better bringing up than his had been, or hers. A wish renewed when 2 years after came a boy to be the rosy idol of her solitudes, while Enoch was abroad on wrathful seas, or often journeying landward. For in truth, Enoch's white horse, Enoch's ocean spoil in ocean-smelling osier, and his face, rough-rend with 1,000 winter gales, not only to the market cross were known, but in the leafy lanes behind the down, far as the portal-warding lion whelp, and the peacock yew tree of the lonely hall, whose Friday fair was Enoch's ministry. Then came a change, as all things human change. 10 miles to northward of the narrow port opened a larger haven. Thither used Enoch at times to go by land or sea. And once while there, and clambering upon a mast in harbor, by mischance, slipped and fell. A limb was broken when they lifted him. And while he lay recovering there, his wife bore him another child, a son, a sickly one. Another hand crept too across his trade, taking their bread and hers, and on him fell, although a grave and staid, God-fearing man, yet lying thus inactive, doubt and gloom. He seemed, as in a nightmare of the night, to see his children leading evermore low, miserable lives of hand to mouth, and her he loved, a beggar. And then he prayed, save them from this, whatever comes to me. And while he prayed, the master of that ship Enoch had served in, hearing his misfortune, came, for he knew the man and valued him, reporting of his vessel, China-bound, and wanting yet a boatswain. There were yet many weeks before she sailed, sailed from this very port. Would Enoch have the place? And Enoch all at once ascended to it, rejoicing at that answer to his prayer. So now that the shadow of misfortune appeared no graver than is when some little cloud cuts off the fiery highway of the sun and isles a light in the offing. Yet the wife, while he was gone, the children, what to do? Then Enoch lay long pondering on his plans. To sell the boat. And yet he loved her well. How many a rough sea had he weathered in her? He knew her as a horseman knows his horse. And yet to sell her. Then, with what she brought, by goods of stores, set Annie forth in trade with all that seamen needed or their wives. So might she keep the house while he was gone. Should he not trade himself out yonder? Go the voyage more than once, yea, twice or thrice, as oft as needed. Last, returning rich, become the master of a larger craft, with fuller profits, lead an easier life, have all his pretty young ones educated, and pass his days in peace among his own. Thus Enoch in his heart determined all. Then moving homeward, came on Anne, pale, nursing the sickly child, her latest born. Forward she started with a happy cry, and laid the feeble infant in his arms, whom he took, and fondled father-like, handled off his limbs, and praised his weight, but had no heart to break his purposes to Annie till morrow, when he spoke. Then, first since Enoch's golden ring had girt her finger, Annie fought against his will. Yet not with brawling opposition she, but manifold entreaties, many a tear, many a sad kiss by day and night renewed, besought him, supplicating, if he cared for her and dear children, not to go. But he, not for his own sake caring, but for hers, hers and her children, let him plead in vain, and so grieving, held his will and bore it through. For Enoch parted with his old sea friend, bought Annie goods and stores, and set his hand to fix their little streetward sitting room, with shelf and corner for the goods and stores. So all day long, till Enoch's last at home, shaking their pretty cabin, hammer and axe, auger and saw, shook and rang till this was done, and his careful hand, the space was narrow, having ordered all, almost as neat and close as nature packs her blossom or her seedling, paused. Then he who needs would work for Annie till the last, ascending tired, heavily slept till morn. Now Enoch faced this morning of farewell brightly and boldly. All his Annie's fears, save as his Annie's, were a laughter to him. But yet he, as grave but God-fearing man, bowed himself down. And in that mystery where God and man is one with man and God, prayed for a blessing upon his wife and babes, whatever came to him. And then he said, "Annie, this voyage, by the grace of God, will bring good fortune yet to all of us. Keep a clear hearth and a clean fire for me, for I'll be back, my dear, before you know it." And then, lightly rocking baby's cradle, and he, this pretty, puny, weakly little one, "For I love him all the better for it. God bless him. He shall sit upon my knees, and I shall tell him tales of foreign parts, and make him merry when I come again. Come, Annie, come, cheer up before I go." Him running on thus hopefully, she heard and not heard him. And then she almost hoped herself. But when he turned the current of his talk to graver things, in sailor fashion roughly sermonizing on providence and trust in heaven, she heard and not heard him. As the village girl, who sets her pitcher underneath the spring, musing on him who used to fill it for her, hears and not hears, and lets it overflow. At length she spoke. "O Enoch, you are wise, and yet, for all your wisdom, well know I that I shall look upon your face no more. Well then," said Enoch, "I shall look upon yours. Annie, the ship I sail in passes here. He named the day. Get you a seaman's glass, spy out my face, and laugh at all your fears." But when the last of those last moments came, "Annie, my dear, come, cheer up before I go. Look to the children, and till I come again, keep everything shipshape, for I must go. And fear no more for me. Or, if you fear, cast all your cares on God, that anchor holds. Is he not yonder in those uttermost parts of the morning? If I flee to these, can I go from him? And the sea is his. The sea is his. He made it." He rose, cast his strong arms about his drooping wife, and kissed his wonder-stricken little ones, but for the third sickly one, who slept after a night of feverish wakefulness. When Annie would have raised him, Enoch stopped her and said, "Wake him not. Let him rest. How should this child remember this?" And kissed him in his cot. But Annie from her baby's forehead clipped a tiny curl and gave him it. This he kept through all his future, but now hastily caught his bundle, waved his hand, and went his way.
Thank you.
not being bred to barter, nor compensating the want with shrewdness, neither capable of lying, nor of asking over much and taking less, and always foreboding. What would Enoch say? For more than once in times of desperation and pressure, has she sold her wares for less than what she gave in buying what she sold. She failed, and saddened knowing it, and thus expected that news which never came, gained for her own a scanty sustenance, and lived a life of silent melancholy. Now the third child was sickly born, and grew yet sicklier, though a mother cared for her with all a mother's care. Nevertheless, whether her business often called her from it, or through the want of what it needed most, or means to pay a voice which best could tell what most it needed, howsoe'er it was, ere she was aware, like a caged bird escaping suddenly, the little innocent soul flitted away. Rose and fixed her watering eyes upon him, on his kindness. Then, calling down a blessing on his head, caught at his hand and wrung it passionately, and passed into the little garth beyond. So lifted up in spirit, he moved away. So Philip put the boy and girl to school, and kept them in it, and bought them needful books, and every way, like one who does his duty by his own, made himself theirs. And though for Annie's sake he oft denied his heart his dearest wish, and seldom crossed her threshold, yet he sent gifts by the children, garden herbs and fruit, the late and early roses from his wall, or conies from the down, and now and then, with some pretext of fineness in the meal, to save the offense of charity, flour from his tall mill that whistled on the waste. But Philip could not fathom Annie's mind. Scarce could the woman, when he came upon her, out of full heart and boundless gratitude, light upon a broken word to thank him with. But Philip was her children's all in all. From distant corners of the street, they ran to greet his hearty welcome heartily. Lords of his house and of his mill were they, worried his passive ear with petty wrongs and pleasures, played with him, hung upon him, and called him Father Philip. Philip gained as Enoch lost, for Enoch seemed to them uncertain as a vision or a dream, famed as a figure seen in early dawn, down at the far end of the avenue, going we know not where. So Philip rested with her, well content, while all the younger ones, with jubilant cries, broke from their elders, and tumultuously down through the whitening hazels made a plunge to the bottom, and dispersed, and beat or broke the lithe, reluctant boughs to tear away their tawny clusters, calling to each other, and crying here and there about the wood. But Philip, sitting at her side, forgot her presence, and remembered one dark hour, when he, like a wounded life, crept into the hollows of the wood. Then he, lifting his honest forehead, "Listen, Annie, how merry they are down yonder in the wood." "Tired, Annie?" She did not speak a word. "Tired?" Thank you. was a thing upon my mind, and it has been upon my mind so long that though I know not when it first came there, I know that it will out at last. Oh, Annie, it is against all hope, beyond all chance, that he who left you 10 long years ago should still be living. Well, then, let me speak. I grieve to see you poor and wanting help. I cannot help you as I wish to, unless... I say the women are so quick. Perhaps you know what I would have you know. I wish you for my wife. I fain would prove a father to your children. I do think they love me as a father. And I'm certain that I love them as if they were my own. And I believe, if you were fast my wife, that after all these sad, uncertain years, we might be still as happy as God grants to any of his creatures. Think on it, Annie. For I am rich and well-to-do. No kin, no care. No burden, save my care for you and yours. We have known each other all our lives. And I have loved you longer than you know. Then answered Annie. Tenderly she spoke. You've been as God's good angel in our house. God bless you for it. God reward you for it, Philip, with something happier than myself. Can one love twice? Can you be ever loved as Enoch was? I am content, said Philip, to be loved a little after Enoch. Nay, she cried, scared as it were. Dear Philip, wait a little. If Enoch comes, but Enoch will not come. Yet wait a year. A year is not so long. Surely I shall be wiser in a year. Oh, Annie, as I have waited all my life, I well may wait a year. Nay, she cried, I am bound. You have my word in a year. Will you not bind your year as I bind mine? And Philip answered, I will bind my year. Here both were mute, till Philip, glancing up, beheld the dead flame of the fallen day pass from the Danish barrow overhead. Then, fearing night and chill for Annie, rose and sent his voice beneath him through the wood. Upward came the children, laden with their spoil. Then all descended to the port, and there at Annie's door, he gave his hand, saying gently to her, Annie, when I spoke to you, that was your moment of weakness. I am always bound to you, but you are free. And Annie, weeping, answered, I am bound. She spoke, and in one moment, as it were, while yet she went about her household ways, even as she dwelt upon his latest words, that he had loved her longer than she knew, that autumn into autumn flashed again, and he stood once more before her, claiming her promise. Is it a year? She asked. Yes, if the nuts, he said, be ripe again. Come on out and see. But she held him off. So much to look to, such a change. A month, give her a month, no more. She knew that she was bound, a month. Then Philip, with his eyes full of that lifelong hunger, and his voice shaking a little like a drunkard's hand. Take your own time, Annie. Take your own time. And Annie could have wept for pity of him. And yet she held him off delayingly, with many a scarce believable excuse, trying his patience and his long suffering, till half another year had passed away. At this, the lazy gossips of the port, abhorrent of a calculation crossed, began to chafe as at a personal wrong. Some said that he did but toy with her, some that she even put him off to draw him on. And others laughed at her, and Philip too, as simple folk that knew not their own minds. And one, in whom all evil fancies clung like serpent eggs together, laughingly would hint worse in either. Her own son seldom spoke, though he often looked his wish. Yet evermore the daughter pressed upon her to wed the man so dear to all of them, and lift the household out of poverty. And Philip's rosy face contracting grew careworn and wan. chanced one night that Annie did not sleep, but instead earnestly prayed for a sign. My Enoch, is he gone? Then, compassed round by the blind wall of the night, brooked not the expectant terror of her heart, suddenly leaped from the bed, struck herself alight, seized the holy book, suddenly set it wide to find a sign, put her finger on the text, under a palm tree. That was nothing to her. Meant nothing. She closed the book, and she closed her eyes, and slept.
Thank you.
prosperously sailed the ship Good Fortune. Though it's setting forth, the Biscay, roughly ridging eastward, shook and nearly overwhelmed her. Yet unvexed, she slipped across the summer of the world. Then, after a long tumble about the cape, she, passing through the summer world again, the breath of heaven came continually and sent her sweetly by the golden isles, till silent in her oriental haven. There, Enoch traded for himself and bought quaint monsters for the market of those times, a gilded dragon also for the bays. Less lucky her home voyage, though indeed at first, through many a fair sea circle, day by day, scarce rocking, her full busted figurehead stare o'er the ripple feathering from her bows. Then followed calms, and then winds variable, then baffling, a long course of them, and last, storms, such as drove her under moonless heavens, till hard upon the cry of breakers came the crash of ruin, and the loss of all, but Enoch and two others. Half the night, buoyed upon floating spars and broken tackle, these drifted, stranding upon an isle at morn, rich, but loneliest in a lonely sea. No want was there of human sustenance, soft fruitage, mighty nuts, nourishing roots, nor save for pity was it hard to take the life so wild that it was tame. There the seaward gazing mountain gorge, these built, and thatched with leaves of palm, a hut, half native cavern. There, set in this Eden of all plenteousness, these rested, ill content. For one, the youngest, hardly more than a boy, hurt in that night of sudden ruin and wreck, lay lingering out 3 years' death and life. They could not leave him. After he was gone, the other two found a fallen stem, and Enoch's companion, careless of himself, fire hollowing this in Indian fashion, fell sunstruck. That other lived alone. In these two deaths, he read God's warning. Wait. The mountain, wooded to the peak, the lawns and glades high up like ways to heaven, the slender cocoa's drooping crown of plumes, the lightning flash of insect and of bird, the luster of the long convolvuses that coiled about the stately stems, the blows and glories of the broad belt of the world, all these he saw. But what he fain would see, he could not. The kindly human face, nor ever heard a kindly voice, but heard the myriad shriek of wheeling ocean fowl, the league-long roller thundering on the reef, the trickle of some precipitous rivulet to the wave, as far down upon the shore he ranged, or often sat in his seaward gazing gorge. Shipwrecked sailor, waiting for a sail.
Haunting people.
the silvering head, the sunny and rainy seasons came and went. His hopes to see his own and pace the sacred old familiar fields not yet had perished when his lonely doom came suddenly to an end. Another ship, she wanted water, blown by baffling winds like the good fortune from her destined course, stayed by the side, not knowing where she lay. For since the maid had seen at early dawn across a break on the mist-wreathen isle, the silent waters slipping from the hills, they sent a crew that, landing, burst away in search of stream or fount, and filled the shores with clamor. Downward from his mountain gorge stepped the long-haired, long-bearded solitary, brown, looking hardly human, strangely clad, muttering and mumbling, idiot-like it seemed, with inarticulate rage, and making signs they knew not what. And yet he led the way to where the rivulets of sweet water ran. And ever as he mingled with the crew and heard them talking, his long-bounded tongue was loosened, till he made them understand, whom, when their casks were filled, they took aboard. And there the tale he uttered brokenly, scarce credited at first, but more and more amazed and melted all who listened to it. And clothes they gave him, and free passage home. But oft he worked among the rest, and shook his isolation from him. None of these came from his county, or could tell him, if questioned, aught of what he cared to know. And dull the voyage was, with long delays, the vessel scarce seaworthy. Yet evermore his fancy fled before the lazy wind, till he, like a lover, down through all his blood, drew in the dewy, meadowy morning breath of England, blown across her ghostly wall. And that same morning, officers and men levied a kindly tax upon themselves, pitying the lonely man, and gave him it. Then, moving up the coast, they left him, even in that harbor whence he sailed before. There, Enoch spoke no word to anyone, but homeward. Home. Had he a home? What home? His home, he went. Bright was that afternoon, sunny but chill, till, drawn through either chasm, where either haven opened onto the deeps, rolled a sea haze and whelmed the world in gray, cut off the length of highway on the floor, and left the narrow breadth to left and right of withered hold, our tilth, our pasturage. On the nigh-naked tree, the robin piped disconsolate, and through the dripping haze, the dead weight of the dead leaf bore it down. Thicker the drizzle grew, deeper the gloom. Last, as it seemed, a great mist-blotted light flared upon him, and he came upon the place. Thus down the long street, having slowly stolen, his heart foreshadowing all calamity, his eyes upon the stones, Enoch came to the home where Annie lived and loved him, and his babes in those far-off 7 happy years were born. But finding neither light nor murmur there, a bill of sail gleamed through the drizzle, crept, still down, thinking, dead, or dead to be. Down to the pool and narrow wharf he went, seeking a tavern which of old he knew, a front of timber-crossed antiquity, so propped, wormy, ruinously old, he thought it must have gone. Yet he was gone who kept it, and his widow, Miriam Lane, with daily dwindling profits, held the house, a haunt of brawling seamen once, but now still, with yet a bed for wandering men. There rested Enoch many days. But Miriam Lane was good and garrulous, nor let him be, but often, breaking in, told him, with other annals of the port, not knowing, Enoch was so brown, so bowed, so broken, all the story of his house, his wife, her baby's death, her growing poverty, how Philip had put the boys and girls to school and kept them at it, his long wooing her, her slow consent and marriage, and the birth of Philip's child. And o'er his countenance no shadow passed, nor motion. Indeed, one regarding, well had deemed he felt the tale less than the teller. Only when she closed, Enoch, a poor man, was cast away and lost. He, shaking his gray head pathetically, repeated, muttering, "Cast away and lost." Again, in deeper inward whispers, "Lost." But Enoch yearned to see her face again. If I could look upon her sweet face once more and know that she is happy. So the thought haunted and harassed him, and drove him forth, when the dull November day was growing duller twilight, to the hill. There he sat, and gazing on all below, a thousand memories rolled upon him, unspeakable for sadness. By and by, the ruddy square of comfortable light, far blazing from the rear of Philip's cabin, allured him, as the beacon blaze allures the bird of passage, till he madly strikes against it, and beats out his weary life. Now Philip's cabin fronted the street, the latest house to landward. But in the rear, walled by a small stone wall, with a little gate that opened out onto the waste, was a tiny garden. And in it flourished an ancient evergreen, a yew tree, and all round it ran a path, and a path divided it. But Enoch shunned this middle walk, and stole up by the wall, behind the yew tree, and thence that which he better might have shunned, if griefs like his have worse or better. Enoch saw. For cups and silver on the burnished board sparkled and shone, so genial was the hearth. And on the right hand of the hearth he saw Philip, the slighted suitor of olden times, stout, rosy, with his babe across his knees. And o'er her second father stooped a girl, a later but a loftier Annie Lee. And from her lifted hand dangled a length of ribbon, and a ring with which to tempt the babe, who reared his creasy arms and caught at it and never missed it. And they laughed. And on the left hand of the hearth, he saw the mother, glancing often toward the babe, but turning now and then to look on him who stood beside her. Son, tall and strong, and saying that which pleased him, for he smiled.
Thank you.
and beating its way up through the weary world, like fountains of sweet water in the sea, kept him a living soul. "Miss Miller's wife," he said to Miriam, "you told me of. Has she no fear her first husband lives?" Aye, poor soul," she said, "fear even now. If you could tell her you had seen him dead, why, that would be her comfort." And he thought, "After the Lord has called me, she shall know. The wait is done." And Enoch set himself, scorning at all things, to work, whereby to live. Almost to all things could he turn his hand. Cooper he was, and carpenter, and helped at loading and unloading the tall barks, whence brought the stinted commerce of the day, and so earned a scanty living for himself. Yet since he did but labor for himself, work without hope it was. There was not life in it whereby the man could live. And so as the year rolled itself round again to meet the day when Enoch had returned, a languor came upon him, a gentle sickness, gradually weakening the man, till he could do no more, kept the house, his bed, and last, his chair. And Enoch bore his weakness cheerfully. For sure, no gladder does the stranded wreck see through the gray skirts of a lifting squall the boat that bears the hope of life approach to save the life despaired of. Then he saw death dawning on him and the close of all. For through this dawning gleamed a kindlier hope on Enoch, thinking, "After I am gone, then may she know I loved her to the last." He called aloud for Miriam Lane and said to her, "Woman, I have a secret. Only swear before I tell you, swear upon the book, never to reveal it till you see me dead." "Dead," clamored the good woman, "hear him speak. I warrant, good man, we shall have you round again in no time. Swear," and Enoch sternly, "on the book." And, half frightened, "on the book," Miriam swore. Then he, rolling his gray eyes upon her, "Did you know Enoch Arden of this town?" "Know him? I knew him far away. I mind him coming down the street. Kept his head high. Cared for no man, he." Slowly and sadly, Enoch answered her, "His head is low, and no man cares for him. I think I have not 3 days more to live. I am that man." At which the woman gave a cry, half incredulous, half hysterical, "You, Arden? Nay. But sure he was a foot higher than you be." And he said again, "My God has bowed me down to what I am today. My grief and solitude have broken me. Sit, listen." Then he told her of his voyage, his wreck, his lonely life upon the isle, his return, how he looked in upon Miriam, upon his wife, how his resolve, and how he kept. And as the woman heard, fast flowed the current of her easy tears, while in her heart she yearned incessantly to rush abroad about the little haven, proclaiming Enoch Arden and his woes. Yet, awed and promise-bound, she forbore, saying only, "See your parents before you go. Hey, Arden, let me fetch them." And rose, eager to bring them down, for Enoch hung a moment upon her words. Then replied, "Woman, disturb me not now, at last, but let me hold my purpose till I die. Sit, listen, mark me and understand, while I still have the power to speak. charge you now. When you shall see her, tell her that I died, blessing her, praying for her, loving her, save for the bar between us, as if she laid her head beside my own. Such a voluble answer, promising all, that once again he rolled his gray eyes upon her, saying all that he wished, and once again she promised. Then on the third night after this, while Enoch slumbered, motionless in the hay, and Miriam lay and watched and dozed at intervals, there came so loud a calling of the sea that all the houses in the harbor rang. He woke, he rose, he spread his arms abroad, crying out in a loud voice, "A sail, a sail!"